still morning? Is it still morning, ain't it? Good morning, Hope's House. I can't hear you. Good morning, Hope's House. All right, y'all got to be a little bit more lively out there. This is our second service. And I don't do mornings all that tough, so y'all got to help me today. Amen. All right. I'm excited on being here. Listen, you have in your midst two of the, in my opinion, best pastors on this side of town, and Pastor Chuck and Pastor Andrea Humphrey. Clap it up for your pastors. It's tough. You don't know how tough it is being a pastor. It gets tough sometimes, and because the weight of it is different. It's different than having a regular job. I heard R.A. Vernon say after he, it's a kind of exhaustion and tiredness that you can't explain. But thank God that they have the grace to be able to do it. Amen. To Devon and everybody else that's here, I'm excited about being here. I'm going to jump right in this thing, if you don't mind. For this particular service, I'm feeling driven the same way, but a different way. And I want to start off by just kind of speaking to the moment that we had. Devon so eloquently has already been used by the Lord. But I want to tell you something about the Holy Spirit. And that is the first thing, God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of a sound mind. Let me tell you something. When I hear things like that, the warrior in me starts to rise up. And let me tell you something. You have power to cast out the devil in situations and things that you go through. And so I want you to know that. So with that being said, there's two things I got confirmation on. One of them was this, is that this past week, I admonished some of our people to pray for your parents. This week, take some time to pray for your parents. Make sure that you cover your parents in prayer. The other thing that I want you to do is pray a hedge around just your loved ones. And the old folks used to say, they prayed a hedge around us. And some of y'all say, what is a hedge? Think of it like an Avengers kind of a thing. It's almost like a barrier that's surrounding you that nothing can get into you. Let me tell you, my mama used to pray prayers that's still working today. She used to pray prayers at 5 o'clock in the morning. You know them prayers that you pray when you moan in the morning time? Some of y'all too young for that, but you want to pray a hedge of protection around your loved ones. And you just say, Lord, I cover all of my loved ones. I cover all of my people. And let me tell you something. We believe in the power of prayer. And so since we don't have fear, we know that when we pray those prayers, God hears us. Amen. Amen. All right. In the book of Judges, Pastor Chuck has already started this series. And it's on standards and boundaries. Somebody say standards and boundaries. Standards and boundaries are an interesting thing. We're going to read a little bit about one of my favorite characters. And I believe the Lord has changed the title for y'all for some odd reason. Not sure, but he knows better than we do. Let's start at chapter number 13, Judges 13. When you get there, say, I'm there. Judges 13, when you get there, say, I'm there. Judges 13, it says this, again, the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord delivered them into the hand of the Philistines for 40 years, and now there was a certain man from Zorah of the family of the Danites whose name was Manoah, and his wife was barren, and he had no children. And the angel of the Lord appeared to the woman and said to her, indeed now you are barren and have no children, but you shall conceive and bear a son. Now therefore, please be careful not to drink wine or a similar drink, and not to eat anything unclean. I told them this morning, you got to be careful like when you are in a spiritual pregnancy, because you can't put everything in your body when God is trying to birth something through you. Amen, somebody. Verse number 5, for behold, you shall conceive and bear a son, and no razor shall come upon his head, for the child shall be a Nazarite to God from the womb, and he shall begin to deliver Israel out of the hand of the Philistines. Jump over to verse number, look at 12, verse number 12, 13 and 12. It says, Manoah said, now let your words come to pass. This is Manoah, the father of Samson, now talking to the angel. Manoah said, now let your words come to pass. What will be the boy's rule of life and his work? Somebody say rule of life. Jump over to chapter number 14. We're almost done reading. Chapter 14, verse number 1. Now Samson went down to Timnah and saw a woman in Timnah of the daughters of the Philistines. So he went up and told his father and his mother, saying, I want this woman right now. Go get her, right? Y'all see that? That's in verse number 14. Jump over to verse number 8. After some time, when he returned to get her, he turned aside to see the carcass of the lion, and behold, a swarm of bees and honey were in the carcass of the lion, and he took some of it in his hands and went along eating. When he came to his father and his mother, he gave some to them, and they also ate. But he did not tell them that he had taken the honey out of the carcass of the lion. So his father went down to the woman, and Samson gave a feast. Somebody say feast. Feast. Somebody say lion.
Lion.
Somebody say feast.
Feast.
Jump over to, this is your last verse, and I'm going to stop reading. Verse number 16 and 22. Verse number 16 and 22. And when you get there, say I'm there. It says, however, the hair of his head began to grow again after it had been shaven. However, the hair of his head began to grow again. Look at your neighbor and tell him, say, I see your hair growing again. I know you rocking that weave right now. It's all good. Just look at him anyway. Say, I see your hair growing again. I know you got a bald head and you ain't got no hair up there, but just look at him and say, I see a little speck coming on that bald head there. I see it. I have figured out this. I have figured out this thing about me and about life and about people and about God is, we don't trust God. Trust in the Lord with how much of your heart? The reality of it is, it's easier for me to trust God with the portions that are easier for me. But when he starts to step into some of what I call my private areas, I don't like to trust him in those pieces, and I want to be honest with you. Trust becomes a difficult thing because the implication of trust is hope, and the implication of hope is failure. In order for me to trust you, that means I have to believe that you may fail me. So the whole thing is that we often see the analogy of somebody falling back and just trusting the person. And so the Lord said to me, he says, John, he said, I want to talk to you about a different level of trust. He said, I don't want you just to think of it as just falling back. He says, I want you to process this particular trust as the trustee to a trust, a living trust. And from my understanding, for those of you who are in business in this room, a living trust, what it does is that it houses all of the assets, houses and everything into this living trust so that it can be administered properly according to the person that is the trustee. Are you with me? The trustee now is the administrator over the trust. The trustee now is the administrator over the trust. I got a homegirl who lost her parents, and when she lost her parents, what ended up happening is that there was no trust. So this her, all of the assets went into what they call probate. When you don't have a trust, then it goes into a place called probate. And what the Lord said to me, he said, there's some people that have spiritual things that has no, that I'm not the trustee over. And so there's going into a locked up place, a spiritual probate, where you can't access your stuff because I'm not the trustee. But the reason why I don't want to be the, I don't want God to be the trustee of my stuff. And see, it's easy. Come here, Devon. It's easy. See, the thing is that I want to, come here. Go on over there. And I want you, this is God. This is the thing. It's for Sunday mornings for me. I want to know your heart. I want to know your heart. Take me. The distance, though, between me and God now, the reality of it is that as long as he's at a distance, then I become the trustee over my own trust, which is impossible, because in order for me to be that trustee, I can't be living. There's a lot of people there's dead men trying to control their trust, and God is like, nah, that's not how it goes. You can't control your own trust. And God says to me, he says, John, you got to get this right now. I said, well, Lord, what's the issue? He says, most people are good with me being God from a distance. Yeah. I want to know your heart. But the reality of it is that as soon as God starts to come closer, because see, the closer, draw me a little closer. Because now when he comes in, now he becomes Lord, not just God. And now he starts to now establish what we call standards over my trust. Now he becomes the dictator of where I go. But I don't want him to be Lord over my life like that, because I like what I was doing. What if he, I mean, let's go to the hard stuff, right? Let's go to the hard stuff. I want to know your heart. Tell me to give some money.
Give some money.
No. I don't want to do that. I want to know your heart. Tell me to stop fornicating.
Stop fornicating, John.
Take me a little closer. Listen, I want for God to be God from a distance. I don't want to make him Lord. And because when he comes in, he comes to administer the trust. He now becomes the trustee over the trust. When he becomes the trustee, then he gives me what we call standards. Standards now have been given this kind of evil term, evil connotation, I should say, because the problem with standards, can I tell you something? I don't know if this is a misuse of the flags, but can I get a flag lady to come up here and bring me two flags up here, please? Two flags, male or female, doesn't matter. Two flags, and go ahead and you be the flag person. You can be the flag person. Yeah, pull them out. It's all good. I can tell you don't do the flags here at the church. I can tell. Okay. All right. All right, Tony, if you can stand right here. Here. The problem with standards that I don't like is, let's stand like this, and then like just cover it like this, just do it like this way so I can't see. The problem with standards is I'm so used to knowing everything. So the problem is God will tell me not to do something because he knows, come here Elijah, because he knows on the other side of this thing right here, go to the other side there, you're going to be the devil, okay? Okay, so because God knows on the other side of this barrier, over this wall, he knows the devil is there. The person that doesn't know the devil is there, though, is me. So all God tells me is, don't do this. That's all he says. He didn't tell you why. He just said, hey, don't do this. And in some places in the Bible, he says, don't do this because. But if you're anything like me, sometimes you got to touch it. I just want to see. I just want to see if it's hot. I just want to. I know you've given me a stand. So what happens is now God now is trying to lead me away from this whole, because I can't see what's happening. He's trying to lead me a different direction, but I'm so bent on going this way, but I can't see what's going to happen. But I'm like, I just want. The problem with standards is that it presents to us now this issue of unknown. We don't do well with unknowns, because now I have to trust God to believe he knows what's on the other end, and that has to be enough for me. Let's bring it to today's context. I argued with God many times. Lord, I missed all these things in my 20s. He said, well, what exactly did you miss, John? Well, on the other side of here, you got heartbreak over here. Over here, you got disease. Over here, you got all kinds of stuff that you missed, but you don't know what's on the other side of it. There was a saying that I used to say when I was a kid, experience is the worst teacher because it gives you the test before the lesson. God now says you don't have to experience everything. I have this thing called standards. And the purpose of the standard now is to prevent you from having a bad experience. Because last time I checked that if I made you, I'm the manufacturer, you're the product. I know how you're wired. So if I tell you don't do something, I know why I'm telling you not to do it. Standards and boundaries is not a punt. Thank you, I'm sorry, you don't have to stand in no more with the flags. And standards is not a punishment from God. We have this thing inside of us that says, oh man, I gotta press the issue. I gotta press the envelope. I gotta try one more thing. Just look straight ahead and people won't know I'm talking about you. Lil Wayne. He porn. What's the point of that? What is he trying to prove? He's trying to prove you can put liquids on electronics. That's something that goes against. Listen, we are so infatuated with going against the grain. The commercial, the whole basis of the commercial is, look what this phone can do. It defies what is normal. It's resistant to liquids. I started thinking about it. Me and my friends, we have battles on phones all the time. This was their main battle. Look, John, I can put it in water. I was looking like, what's the big deal about being able to put it in water? There's something in our minds that says, hey, listen, I'm just infatuated with this whole idea of pressing the envelope. I want to do something different. This is the standard, but I want to go beyond that. Our minds are totally just that way. We start a diet. And after we start the diet, we have this wonderful thing that we do, and it's called a cheat day. This is what we're saying. I'm eating correctly. I'm going to take a break from eating correctly. That's in essence what we're saying. I'm going to take a break from eating correctly. I'm going to take a cheat day because the standard of eating correctly is so difficult and so arduous. But the only reason why it's so hard is because I have a culture already of doing the wrong thing. And Deuteronomy chapter 30 verse 19, he says, I put before you life and death, and then he gives you the answer. He says, choose. Trusting God now means I trust him to be the Lord of my life, which means that he's the trustee of my life, which then gives me this whole thing where he now becomes the Lord and director of my life, and he sets the standards because he knows what's on the other side, even the stuff that I can't see. So for all of us creative people and people that gotta know, Noah, Don't touch the fire. It's hot. Okay, Dad. It's almost like we are hypnotized by the word no. I submit to you the definition of a standard. I want you to look at this, and if you're taking notes, write this down. The definition of a standard is a manual from the manufacturer explaining how a product is to be put together and the proper way to use the product. Jesus now, God now, has given us a manual. This manual is not a book of laws that try to get you not to do something. It's not to try to stop you from letting your hair down. John, you preaching. Thank you very much. I appreciate it. It is not to do that. The whole purpose of a standard is a manual, because he's trying to show you how you are designed and made up. Based upon your design, I made you, so I know what's going to happen if you do these things already. So I'm going to tell you, don't do those things so that you can now succeed and have a life worth living, as opposed to having death. I put before you life and death, therefore choose. My boy Samson. The Lord changed the title for y'all. Your title is Your Hair is Growing Back. Let me tell you what just happened in that worship moment, is that the Lord now in your heart now established something where he wants to now begin today with a brand new standard, something different. He says, I'm growing their hair back. Some of us in here, we have so many regrets. I want to talk to some people that's done some crazy stuff, and some people that's made some wrong decisions, or you've been, you know, thinking crazy. You've done some things that you're not proud of. But let me tell you something, is that even Samson at the end of it, his hair grew back. Today I'm telling you is you can make a decision today to establish a new standard today, because God wants to grow your hair back. My boy Samson, his father asked this question. He says, what shall be your rule of life? I love the story of Samson because with his whole, he was a Nazirite, which means there was a list of things, there was a standard that was set that he's not supposed to do. Come here for a second. Let me tell you something about that. But good old Samson. Samson, although he was a Nazirite and there were some things he wasn't supposed to do, he still did some of those things. Amen, somebody.
Amen.
So this is the deal, is that in this scripture, I told him this morning, there is a rhythm in the text. It's supposed to be the same every time. It's supposed to go children of Israel with God, children of Israel, they sin, children of Israel, they cry out to God, God sends a deliverer. That is the sequence of every story in the rhythm of the Bible. It's the cycle of the way they do things in Scripture. They, just like some of us, we with Jesus, we then sin, we get in some trouble, so we cry out to God, come save me, and then God comes to send deliverance. And this particular passage, though, what you find here is this, is that they don't cry out to God to come and save them. God sends a deliverer without them crying for one. God sends a deliverer without them crying for one. What does this mean? Point number one, write this down. You can live with no standards for so long that the mediocre lifestyle becomes satisfactory. I can live so long in the, the children of Israel had gotten so deep into this lifestyle with low standards. They got so far into it that this is what happened. They became accustomed to that thing. Yeah, I know. You've been with him for 15 years, and y'all not married yet, but you just, you know, the bottom line is the reason why you're settling because you don't think you're good enough. Many times what we do is that the reason why I lower the standard and I make the bar so low is because I want actually people to be able to get in, because really when I look in the mirror, I don't feel secure in my own self. So how can I require a standard of somebody else, but when I look in the mirror, I am overshadowed with a whole bunch of insecurity? Can I talk to some people in here? Let me see. Let me tell you, the greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Let me tell you something. Regardless to what you see in the mirror, if you dare to have a standard, let me tell you about this spirit. Well, let me tell you about this whole thing. The spirit of fornication are some of those things. Some of those sins don't happen because you just like them. Some of those sins happen because you have a low self-esteem. You have a self-esteem issue. And since you have a self-esteem issue, your laundry list of people that you sleep with, that you do things with, is so long, because not because you're trying to go against God, but because you don't think that much of yourself. Snap out of it. These two commandments are the commandments I leave you with. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, your mind, your... And love your neighbor as... The interesting thing I love about this scripture, then, and what I discovered then, is that if I don't have the proper love for me, then I will automatically abuse you. We have some people that are abusers, and the reason why they're abusers is because they're abusers of themselves. I want to talk to some people that are committing emotional suicide on a regular basis in this room. Emotional suicide causes you not to have no standards because somebody told you you wasn't nothing. Somebody told you you don't look pretty. Somebody told you all these things, and so you try to make it up, and you try to put on so many images and do so many things to cover it up. But today, the Lord says, I want to grow your hair back so you don't have to need the validation of people. You're getting beat up every single morning, the devil beating you up because you think you ain't good enough. And so what he does is he just reminds you of the sin part, because you think the sin is the problem. No. It is the way you look at yourself that's the problem. That's the why you ain't got no standards. You didn't come from a lineage of people who passed on good culture to you. So now, because they said you wasn't nobody, you think you nobody. We don't just lower our standards for no reason. But this is the thing. How much am I worth with the Christ in me? Okay. I love this scripture. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. God, in all his wisdom, somehow decides to put something precious in this. Watch this. You remove that, my value changes. But when you put that in me, I now have the standards of God on the inside of me, and I got the nerve to let some joker take me out to eat and they don't pay for the meal? We're talking about standards here. I got the nerve to go out. He don't pay for the meal. He don't open the door. He ain't no gentleman. And I allowed that to happen as a woman of God. What are you thinking? Letting somebody take you out and do all that kind of stuff, and then you give them some benefits at the end? How are you going to give them some benefits at the end? They ain't even done nothing. Listen, we ain't even talking about the Bible yet. I mean, can you just raise it enough for them to pay for a meal? To raise our standards. I think so low of myself, I just let anybody do anything to me, say anything to me. People think I'm crazy. I didn't got a mohawk and going through a midlife crisis. I'm going crazy. I'll be walking around. Did you say something to me? There comes a time in your life where you gotta know what's in you. Samson and his people now have gotten to the place where they've been in so long, they're just mediocre. God now has to send them a deliverer, and they didn't even ask for it. Point number two, let's get out of here. Picking by your senses alone is picking with no sense at all. Samson in chapter 14, verse number 1, it says that he went down to Timnah and he chose a woman that was a Philistine. His parents then said to him, dude, what you doing? Why are you choosing a woman, watch this, with a sinful background? He looked back at his mama and said, I just want somebody. I get her saved. I got the power in me. You know, listen, I'm not going to be listening to Pastor Dre and all that because they married and stuff, and I'm by myself, so, you know, you know, I understand all this stuff that they're saying, but at the end of the day, God knows that I need a pair of legs with me. This is how, I'm just talking the way we talk when we're not in church. The reality of it is now he's picking based upon his senses. And I told him this morning, everybody in this room, please say this word. It's going to bless you. Say cohabitation.
Cohabitation.
Say it one more time, cohabitation.
Cohabitation.
Put a little extra on the H for me this time. Cohabitation.
Cohabitation.
Let me tell you what people don't focus on. You're so focused on how she looked. No. Hold on. Let's backtrack. Thank you, Holy Ghost. I am not telling you you shouldn't be concerned about the way you look. Let me help the saints. All this jib-jab, just take me how I am and all that kind of stuff. Okay, all right, okay. See, you need to have a standard also about the way you look. You need to present yourself a certain way. She would be, my sister would be watching. I ain't gonna say that. I get hit when I get home. Listen, do something with yourself. I'm gonna just leave it there. I'm gonna leave it there. Do something with yourself. Listen, there needs to be a stand. Listen, there needs to be a standard that you have with yourself personally. If you're not happy with you, how is somebody else going to be happy with you? Now, to the other point. Cohabitation. I have to understand that when I'm building standards, I can't base it just on my senses. Because my senses is not cohabitation. I see this person. How many single people? Wave at me. Single. All right, let me say this word. I'm married. Okay? You are married. Okay, great. So, you are married. If you are married, you see something first. That's the first bite, especially if you're a guy, right? The key, though, is can you live with the person? We call that
cohabitation.
She fine, but she mean as a dog. You didn't know that. He got muscles, but he just want to lay in his mama's lap all day. Some of y'all in here are rocking some overgrown babies. You need to stop. Some overgrown babies that were over-nurtured. I'm not going to get on that. Let me tell you something. When you over-nurture, since you asked, we're talking about standards. When you over-nurture, let me tell you what you're doing. When you over-nurture a boy, he then expects every woman to over-nurture him. Then the woman gets mad because you're paying all the bills and he's not doing nothing. Well, that's the way he was raised. Ooh, yes. Picking by your senses alone is picking with no, your senses is not enough for you to establish a standard for what you gonna do. You gotta go beyond the outside. Trust me, there's some beautiful people in the world, but when I tell you they crazy as they wanna be. Then you walking down the aisle and then you say, I do. And then now you're like, oh, Lord, what have I done? Well, now it's cohabitation time. Point number three, compromise makes my resistance frail. This whole thing with Samson did not happen with Delilah. Actually, I didn't tell him this morning. Delilah wasn't the first woman that got him to do something based upon them pestering him. His wife did it first. So now, watch this. His problem that he was having, he already had a rhythm of compromise. Let me tell you about compromise. Once you do it, once, it gets easier to do it the next time. Compromise now makes it frail, makes your resistance frail. Why is that important? It says this, God says like this, he says, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will. Some of us, the devil, we'd be like, go devil. He'd be like, I ain't going nowhere. You have no resistance towards me. You've been compromising for 5 months. And now you want to pray and try to cast me out? No, 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 no. Actually, you can't kick me out of the house that you built. You built the house for me. So I'm going to sit in this house because you built the house for me. Now you're telling me to get out? Because you don't like what I'm doing. Well, I've been planning this for 5 months. I just got to, today is your embarrassment day. Today is your shame day. Today is the day. So you can't cast me out today. I'm not finished because I have a house. I made a house inside of your situation. Am I preaching?
Yeah.
I think so. There's two places where we find the compromise makes resistance frail. Chapter 14, verse number 8 and verse number 10. And the first thing you see is he touches the lion. He touches the lion. A Nazirite is not supposed to touch anything dead. We said that there was a corpse of a lion. He touched the lion. The other part is the feast. With the feast, they went to the woman's house, the Philistine's house, to have this party, to do a turn-up. The turn-up now has wine. He's not supposed to drink no wine. Before Delilah, he was already opening the floodgates for his hair to be shaved off. We focus on the hair being shaved off. Before he did any of that, he had already opened the door. Some of us have doors open. The Lord is saying, close the doors. Close the doors. How do I close the doors? Start off by shutting off that TV. Start off by staying off of Showtime at night. Start off by staying off some of those. Stop letting the devil input all this stuff inside of you. That's where you start. Y'all real quiet in here. Say amen. There's always a proving period. Go to the next point. There's always a proving period. Somebody say proving period. This is what you will find in this scripture. You see where it says there was a lion and it says there were bees swarming in the lion. That don't even make sense. When there's a corpse, you have flies, not bees. You don't have bees, you have flies. Why is there bees? Because there's honey in it, because now there's a proving period. Before Jesus starts his ministry, God says, this is my son of whom I'm well pleased. And the next verse says, and he was led by the Spirit to be tempted by the devil. Let me tell you something. The reason why you got so much temptation around you is because you one step away from the place you're supposed to be at. And you think that's the reason why some of us in here, it ain't sex. It's just your mouth. You can't shut it. You don't know what to do. Your mouth just kind of goes and you find yourself now getting to these altercations with people all the time. Let me tell you what that is. That God is trying to get you to stop because there's something on the other end of it. So now Samson has this lion in front of him. He's not supposed to take. God is trying to give him, watch this, some preparation. Sometimes before you get to your place that you're supposed, you got to have a proving space to prove that you can handle the space that you go into. But he does like some of us do. He dips into that honey. And the scripture says he took it back to his parents. And they ate it. But he didn't tell them, I got this from something that was dead. I'm going to hit y'all with this. I told them this morning. They didn't like it, but I'm going to tell y'all. I got to be careful about who I embrace. That's why my standard got to be high, because I don't know what they've been touching. So now I receive now a spiritual STD. Because I don't know what they have been touching. So now I wake up one day and I'd be like, man, they'd be like, you start asking you questions like, where do you want to go? You'd be like, I don't know. You'll never know. You can just confuse. Let me tell you what that is. There's sometimes we are touching people that have touched so many things. You gotta investigate what people be touching. What you touching on? Yeah. I ain't gonna say that. Thank you, Holy Ghost. There's always a proving period. You are in, the reason why God now, why does he take this month to tell your pastors to talk about standards? God doesn't do nothing for no reason. He does it for a reason. There's something on the other end. Somebody in here been praying for something that requires a higher standard. God, give me this. No problem. Raise your level to this. Last point. Temporary allowance does not mean approval. Just because I get away with it, don't mean God cool with it. People of God, just because you get away with it today, it don't mean God cool with it. Let me just flat out say, God ain't cool with it. Amen. He was talking to me the other day. He was like, Jay, I ain't cool with that. I don't like when God talked to me like that. I just want to just worship. Can I tell you a secret, though? You will never experience true worship where an infinite God is infinite, where an infinite God now comes down on your finite body where he doesn't check something about you. I don't know if y'all felt it, but in that moment, while I was worshiping, I had a grateful heart, but immediately with a grateful heart, I start thinking about all the crap, and I'm just like, man. But what is worship doing? Worship now is bringing to the surface the real me. You can't hide from God. Worship brings it to the surface and goes, my homeboy, his name is Pastor Larry, he says something interesting. He says, people think it's praise and worship, but he says it's really worship and praise. He says praise came as a result of Leah. Judah was named praise after there was a mistake that was made. Let you chew on that. But literally I thought about it. Worship is something that gets on the inside. That's the reason why Hope's House spends so much time in worship. Worship does a whole bunch of stuff that we can't do. Like a human being, there's certain things you can't change. But this is what I'm trying to tell you. In this worship moment today, what you got was the grace to raise your standard. Yeah. All right. Married people, keep going. Married people. Holler at me, married people. I'm going to tell y'all this. This is, I'm transparent. These are some things that I did horribly wrong. So if you do opposite of what I'm telling you, these things, because I did these things horribly wrong. Number one, establish a rule of life. Y'all see that? The daddy asked the angel, what shall be his rule of life, or what shall be his constitution? This is what you want to do. Married people, holler at me. Sit down and figure out a list of things and set a standard of how you're going to maneuver, and you want to do it when you're in love. So wait till everybody's like, oh, you look so beautiful. Oh, you did that. That's when you want to sit down and do it. Let me give you an example of a standard. We will not go to bed mad. Yes. What's the scripture you put with that? Don't let the sun go down on your wrath. Right? If you're married, somebody say married.
Married.
If you're married, then I will show due benevolence regardless of whether I'm mad or not. Due benevolence, sex. I will have sex regardless to whether if I'm mad or not. Ain't nobody say amen. Somebody better say something in the church. I don't know why people get mad. This is in the, hey, listen, we said a standard is the manufacturer knows the way the product is made. The scriptures say to show due benevolence unless both of y'all agree to fasting. Uh-oh. Can I talk to the deep people out there? Well, what you jicking for? The Lord is leading me to a fast. You married. The Lord ain't leading you nowhere you ain't talked about. The scripture says when you go on a fast, it needs to be a mutual agreement.
Yep.
Come here real quick. Shh, don't tell nobody. That's the reason why most men don't come to church. Because they can't understand why a God that you would serve would turn you against them. Let me get this straight. The Lord told you to fast. And you mean as all get out. So I already got to deal with you being mean. Now I got to deal with you ain't giving no ministry. Unstable standards can push your spouse into the arms of another person. Sarah, God's word wasn't enough for her, so she said, why don't you go hang out with Hagar for a minute? Then she got mad at the result. Some of us, we don't follow the standards, and then we get mad at the result. I want to admonish us and challenge us to take responsibility. Just take responsibility and go, hey, listen, I need to change these things while I still have the chance to change them. That's why, I mean, we laughing a lot or whatever, but I'm going to tell you, it's crazy. It's crazy how many people I watch. It's almost like a wedding ring has some kind of seance on it or something. I feel like it's almost like as soon as you put it on, it'd be like, zoop. Your brain goes, for the guys, I'm going to look sloppy. I'm not going to make sure my nails is clean. I ain't going to get no more haircuts. For the woman, it's like, it don't matter. I'm going to put a head wrap on every single night. You ain't going to never see my hair done. Like, can I keep it real? What is it about that thing that makes you turn into, like, this person? You get all boring and you what's wrong with you? I tell people, Bishop only allows me to do premarital now. I can't do post, but this is the deal. Get out of my business. Anyway, this is the deal. This is the deal. Trip this. So you got, I ask people this, tell me the person, and y'all can try this at home. If you're married, tell me the person that you would deem like some kind of movie star, person like that, somebody real distant that you would say, I want this person as a girlfriend or a boyfriend. Right? What you will see is your spouse has a thought process and a concept of what they want. And if you never ask them, you'll be walking around just looking crazy. And they'll be in their brains be wishing you had some kind of spice in your life. I want to get more detail, but I come back on that. I can feel myself going to a space, so let me push. Unmarried people, holler at me. Y'all got a whole bunch. This is all stuff I extracted from the Samson story, right? Number one, you want to check their culture before you marry them. By culture, I mean, how do they flow? What is their flow? Like, what is their way of doing what they do? You want to check their flow. What's their family history? How do they process through some things? You want to check the culture, because the culture may be so different from yours that it can cause some friction there. My pastor calls it fire and friction, right? Those things can cause some issue. Number two, make sure your standards go beyond looks. We already talked about that. Make sure your standards go beyond looks. Now, as an addendum to that one, I want to make sure I look good. Don't get so churchy where you be like, it don't matter how I look, long as Jesus. Okay. Yeah, I want, that is true. Long as Jesus, you know, whatever, but I want to make sure I look good for me, you know, and I feel good about me. Amen. Number three, investigate what they are capable of while emotional. Number three is so important. My mama, I used to say, oh, mom. Oh, mom, I love this girl. She'd be like, you seen her mad yet? I'd be like, nah. She said, well, you don't know. People turn into people. When they get mad, you'd be like, what happened to the soft, docile, quiet? You gotta wait until somebody gets under pressure. Then you see, there you go. I see you. And then you ask yourself, my mama said it this way, can I live with that? Not the stuff we do where you be like, you get mad, you go to your house, I go to my house. Can I Man, that was some organ right there. Number four, premature vulnerability will kill you emotionally. If you are unmarried, I admonish you with all my heart to stop giving secrets. Don't give secrets until you get an engagement ring and you 2 weeks from marriage. I don't understand. You've been with the person for 1 week. You'd be like, and then what happened is when I was young and I was doing that. Blah, blah, blah. Because while you talking, he calculating. That's how I get that. Okay. All I got to do is say this and say that. That's what happened to Samson. He gave up secrets. And his vulnerability literally got him killed. Watch your secrets. Secrets, that's you giving a portion of you to somebody else. Set a standard that goes, okay, I'm going to reserve. You got to pick and choose. I'm going to reserve this. Amen? Check relationship history. Who have you been with? We don't ask these questions in relationship, but let me tell you something. That is an anointed question. Who? How many? Because if I'm about to connect and put my whole life in your hands, I need to know what you're doing. I know you say, man, PJ, this is called standards and boundaries. The standards and boundaries. At the end of the story, although Samson had messed up, the scripture says his hair grew back. I say this today prophetically. Today, God knew we were talking about standards. So before we talked about it, what he decided to do was, let me grow their hair back first. Yeah. I want to give them a chance today to establish new standards. Stop thinking so, I'm done, bro. Stop thinking so low of yourself. Stop thinking so low of yourself. Trust God enough to make him the trustee of your life. Make him your person. Man, and resist that urge to have to see everything. That ain't how he operates, man. He told Abraham, go to a place I'm gonna show you. And that was it. And he just went. He told the children of Israel when they were coming out of Egypt, he says, let me take them around this way, because if I take them this way, they're not ready to fight. God knows what we're ready to do and what we're not. He sets the standard and the pace because he knows us, man. PJ, I made all the mistakes you already said already. Man, I made some of my own self. I made some mistakes also. But this is what I thank God about, is that he grows your hair back, dude. He gives you another chance. Today is the day. The day you hear my voice, harden not your heart. Bow your heads. You in this room. And you're like, I heard this word. I'm going to be honest, I got some trust issues, or I got some stuff in me, but I understand I got to have a standard. I got to raise my standard. God is giving me another chance. I want somebody to agree with me in prayer. That's what I want. I don't want you to think about it. I just want you to walk towards me. Just come so we can pray with you. I want to raise my standard. Don't even think about it. Just come. Don't even let the devil... I don't care if you got a position in the church. I don't care. I need to raise my standard. I am not going to keep lowering my standard for nobody, because I'm going to think something about myself. I'm not going to just keep doing the same thing. Listen, I got a standard. I'm going to stop watching the pornography. I'm going to stop doing that stuff. I just heard God say this. It's just like the scripture says that the lepers came to Jesus, he healed them. They got healed while they were walking. Let me tell you something. If you take this step and you say, hey, listen, I'm going to take this step, while you're walking, God's going to start doing something on the inside of you while you're walking. I'm still waiting for a few of y'all. I can still feel like some of y'all need to get up here and say, hey, listen, there's some standards. I need to establish some things, man. This is what I love about the Samson story. There's a little boy that guided him to the space to where he was supposed to be. Somebody had to intercede for him. Can I get some intercessors up here? Can I get some intercessors up here? Everybody take one. Take one. Everybody take one. All the intercessors take one. At this altar, there's somebody that's going to pray with you, but I want you just to lift your hands in the presence of the Lord. I want you to start to just give that thing to God. Like when I say raise your hands, I'm asking you to do that because it means I surrender. Like, I want to raise my standard. I am tired of being tired. I am tired of lowering my standard for people. I want God to do something. I want God to move some stuff in my life. You talk to him. Come on, talk to him. Don't be afraid to talk to him. Don't be afraid to talk to him. I got one right here. Oh, you got her. I want to raise my standard. I want to raise my standard. I want to raise my standards. He is for me.
Protect me from things.
If you're still here at the altar, or if you are going back to your seats, I want to tell you this before you go back. This is your homework. Manoah asked the angel, what shall be his rule of life? I want us now to, when you get to your seat, I want you to reestablish a constitution that says, this is the new me. This is the standard that I'm going to keep. It don't have to be a whole bunch of stuff. It could just be four or five things. Say, this is what I'm going to do. It's important that you put it in writing, because when you put it in writing, it's established. Amen. Amen. God, we seal everything that's happened here at this altar. Every single thing, God, that you've called us to be. We won't think low of ourselves anymore. We will raise our standard to where you would have us to be. And we commit now to the standard that you've given us. We praise you and we honor you for it right now. In Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Can y'all do me a favor? Can we clap our hands for what the Lord has done? Now I want to challenge you with something for this particular service. Let me tell you, there's a rumor about 11 o'clock services everywhere, not just here, but even at our church. And that rumor is that the 11 o'clock service doesn't support vision, but I come against that. That's not true. Look at your neighbor and say, that ain't true. I can't hear you. Say, that ain't true. This is the deal. What I want to do today is I want to challenge you the same way God now has challenged us to raise our standards in our lives and our relationships. He's also challenging us to raise our standard when it comes to giving. And I think we can clap on that. We can clap on that. This is what I want to explain to you about that trust part. I told him this morning, is trusting God to be the Lord of everything. And this, I'm not saying this to take a, I'm not taking a jab at anybody. I'm just presenting a fact to you. Sometimes, and if you do this, that's fine. But I'm just saying, some of us have more trust in a machine that we drop money in and pull a lever than we do in the God that we serve. So I want to challenge you now, and I'm challenging you by the Holy Spirit, to do something different. We usually come to church, we make up our mind, oh, I'm going to give $10, or I'm going to give $5, or $1. What I want you to do today is do something that says, I trust God. You know what that is. My daddy used to say it like this: this offering may not pay my bills, but it'll cause my bills to get paid. If I don't have enough anyway, I need to give this, what I don't have, to the God that multiplied the two fishes and the loaves of bread. If I give it to him, my expectancy is that he's going to pull me through it. I ain't no prosperity preacher or nothing like that, but I believe God. I believe God. True story. I started a series on a Bible study night, because what I realized is that our generation doesn't even know what a blessing is anymore. So Lord, he says, man, I want you to preach that you are blessed. My car went through the situation with my car. The Lord gave me a car, gave me a Mercedes, right? And I was shouting about it, right? I was shouting about it till it was time for an oil change. Watch this. because God now had raised my standard, but I wasn't ready for the payment that went along with the standard that was raised. Some of us, so now I got this car and I got this maintenance, and so I took it down to the place, and he said, man, it's going, for all this stuff, man, it's going to cost you $6,000. And I said, what? My pastor asked me to come to church and do something that I didn't want to do. I'm going to be honest with you. Bishop said, come to the church and do this and so. And I was like, oh. I didn't want to do it, honestly. I went and did what he asked me to do, but when I got there, there was a preacher dude that was there. He said, man, John, I hear your car. Let me give you a number to this guy to call, right? And I said, okay. So I went about a week or two. I finally called the guy because this guy works at the Mercedes dealer. So I'm thinking if it's the dealer, it's going to be a grip, right? So the dude calls me back and he says to me, he said, man, for all this stuff, he says, man, you know what? I'm going to do it for you for $1,500. I said, you're going to do $6,000 worth of work for $1,500? He says, yeah, man, you are a preacher like the other man. He said, I'm going to do it for $1,500. What I realized about God, watch this, I got a $4,500 credit.
Go ahead.
Just because it didn't pass physically through my hand, it still passed through my hand. I wish I had somebody that understood the way the Lord works. The Lord can take something. Let me tell you something. He says, why do you store up stuff here on this earth? He says, you need to store it up in heaven. I told him at our church, I got a spiritual bank that I draw from with my spiritual credit card. Because this is the thing. He said, I will give seed to the. Let me explain it to you though. I'm gonna give seed to the. Which means if I don't sow, I ain't got no. Which means if I won't see, then I gotta. Because he gives to the. Why am I talking to you? I want to build your faith. Listen, expect God to do something. The ushers are serving you now. If you need an envelope, raise your hand. Fill out that envelope. Pray and ask God, Lord, what do you want me to do? I'm going to raise my standard when it comes to giving. I want to raise my standard. You bring me some money, Rich. Y'all got an offering song? Okay. Cool. Do something that shows I trust God. I trust God with my substance, even with my money. I trust him with everything. Huh? What I tell him this morning? I told him this morning. Everything that you sow, it's a face attached to it. You follow me? Like there are people attached to every dime that you give. So, Hope's Development Center and all this other stuff. And I'm gonna be honest with y'all. I told y'all this. The leadership heard me tell my story. Y'all sowing the people like me. That got in some trouble. Amen, somebody. So if it wasn't for Hope's House, Jon Decuir wouldn't have no hope. Does that make sense? So wave your offerings at me if you have them. Wave them at me. Let me wave them at me. Amen. y'all gonna bring the baskets down? Do we walk in the service too? Okay. Everybody stand to your feet. We gonna walk. This aisle. Okay, everybody, this aisle, And that's our face this way. That was good? Okay. And this over here, this our face that way. There we go.
Can we please give a big hand for Pastor Jon Decuir and that incredible message? Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Have your seats, have your seats, have your seats. If you were in the 8 o'clock service, please go back and listen to that because it was almost completely different. This was great. It was like he preached two different sermons. Fantastic, amazing. I'm gonna give you these announcements. We're gonna get out of here real quick. In case you guys don't know, today we're starting off our summer sermon series. Pastor Jon is one of the first of several guest preachers, friends of our pastors, friends of the ministry that will be coming in, and they will be feeding us the word. Hallelujah. So I'm going to give you the dates. Pastor Jon, who preached today, of course. And then at the end of this month, on June 26th, Pastor Michael Field from Fellowship Monrovia, if you were at Vision Day, he was one of the speakers there at Vision Day. He'll be here. And then also from Detroit, Michigan, Pastor Tyron Meredith on July 10th, and I'm excited about him. And then we also have Pastor Jon coming back on July 24th, so he'll be back again next month with a whole new whole new thing to do. And then we're going to close out everything with Pastor Albert Tate on August 7th. On August 7th, Pastor Albert Tate, who just met with the Pope, apparently. yeah, crazy things. He's coming to preach to us, and he just got done talking to the Pope. God is good. Hallelujah. We also have water baptism today. Our own Megan Macklin is getting dipped in the water today at 4 o'clock at Heritage Christian School. That's 17531 Rinaldi Street in Granada Hills. If you want to be a part of that, you can meet them there. Also, if you wish to be water baptized, come see myself or any of the constituents from the ministerial staff. We would love to get your information and tell you more about it. Also today at 2 o'clock, Casitas Care. Next door, we're going to venture on over. We're going to meet right here on my left, your right, in this section at 1:30. And we're going to gather together and let you guys know the game plan. It's an amazing, wonderful experience. I promise you, it's not work. It's great. I love it. The people there are great, and they appreciate it. Please, please take some time today and go over to Casitas Care. Also, HCDC. Pastor Chuck, come on up, because you're going to grab the mic, man. Come on up. Come on up. Come on.
Amen, amen, amen. Praise God. We've been announcing we're having our second annual golf tournament this coming Friday, the 17th. And many folks have already signed up. Thank you for those who signed up. Thank you for those. How many folks had a chance to sell or buy a helicopter ball? Helicopter ball, just a couple. The rest of y'all need to get in on the fun, man. Listen, we're having with the golf tournament. If you don't golf, no problem. But you can still support, and you can encourage your friends and family and your neighbors to support also. There's brochures outside. They can give online, make a donation. For $10, you can buy a helicopter ball, which is a ball that we numbered, and your number will be dropped from a helicopter at several thousand feet, dropped on the course, and if your ball goes in the hole, you can win up to $2,000. I think that's a good deal. $10, that's more than that slot machine thing that y'all have faith in, amen? But listen, this is a way to get the community involved. Pastor John said there are faces attached to every gift, amen? And there are people who come to this church, not because of church, but they bring their kids to Camp Hope in the summertime, amen. They come to the Christmas extravaganza in the wintertime. We have snow out there in the parking lot. People of all nationalities, backgrounds that we never see in church get touched by us because we have Hope Community Development Center, which Pastor Dre runs, okay? So we need you to get involved. This is our last week to raise money. See the folks. My brother Shimoda will be at the desk outside. There may be some folks who still want to golf, but by all means, please, if you haven't contributed already or bought a helicopter ball for the helicopter ball drop, or you have friends and family that you said, I can ask them for $10. They can sign up online. It's very easy, but we need all of us to participate so we can touch the community. Amen? We want to invite all the folks to come out this coming Friday, 12:30, they'll be dropping the balls from the helicopter. We want to invite kids and families to come out to see this event, cheer it on, pray for your ball to go in, all that fun stuff. It's going to be, and this is free. Just show up and be out there, part of the crowd. Those who are golfing will be having lunch and dinner and things like that. But if you just want to come out and be a part of the festivities, please come out about 12 o'clock, 12:30. Between 11 and 1, it's time for just come out. We actually have time for kids to have a free putting contest. They can win games, win prizes also, okay? So we're making it a family affair. Then we'll golf, but we need your involvement. Praise God. Can you all help me out today? How many folks can buy a ball? At least one. $10. That's two Starbucks, right? Amen. That's a Big Mac and some fries and a Frappuccino, okay? Y'all can do that, okay? So thank you. See you, Brother Shimoda, outside. And Devon, I'll give it back to you as you leave.
Oh, got it. Sorry. The screen said Casitas Care was next week. It's actually today. It's today. Amen. Who's been to McDonald's in the last 2 weeks? Tell the truth. Don't lie in here. Who's been to McDonald's in the last 10 weeks? You bought fast food the last 2 weeks. You bought fast food. Ooh, Christians. You ain't bought no fast food? Who's had something fried in the last 2 weeks? Okay, now we're talking. Now we're here. Now we're here. Yeah, okay. I want you to think about this. I want you to think about this, okay? I want you to think about this, and I'm going to move on. Okay? Fried foods are killing us. Amen? Tastes great, don't it? Killing us, okay? You can spend $10 on fried food and kill yourself. That's what we're doing. That's what we're doing. Or we can spend $10 and possibly get $2,000 in return. Life, death.
It also helps the kids. I'm being very practical, just in common sense. It's helping the kids, but that's not what y'all thinking. Y'all ain't really thinking about the kids. Because if you don't value your own life by eating fried foods, I know you ain't thinking about the kids, huh? Look at me, all fat. Y'all look like a hypocrite. Yeah, well, I'm in the gym every day. Join me, won't you? Family Day at the Park 2016, July 17th is going down, homie. It's going down. It's going to be great. Listen, we have karaoke for all you singers out there. I hear you guys in the crowd. We have karaoke, and it's not just going to be gospel karaoke. It's going to be PG, but it ain't, you know, it's not just going to be total praise and and church hymns, okay? We have a tug of war contest, and then we have this new thing that we're doing called the Hope's House Shuffle that we're going to be teaching. It's this dance that we're going to be doing, and I'm so excited because I'm extremely uncoordinated, and I'm going to dance by faith. So I want you guys to join with me at the park. We're going to learn this brand new thing. I'm telling you, it's going to be great. We have a much bigger announcement next week, but mark your calendars. July 17th, directly after church, we'll be going over and we'll have the picnic. Amen? All right, let's keep moving. Arts and Entertainment. Arts and Entertainment invites you to Masters at the Getty Museum Saturday, June 18th at 4 p.m. That's the day before Father's Day. 4 p.m. Admission is free. Hallelujah. Parking is $10. After 4 p.m. and 15 before 4 p.m. Carpooling is recommended. And then lastly, we are desperately looking for volunteers for several summertime activities that will be going on. If you're interested in helping us and volunteering, we would truly appreciate it. Outside, right outside, there will be a sign-up sheet for you. You can find it at the information booth. Just sign your name up. We're not asking you to give us slave hours. We just need a little bit of manpower to help us pull some things off. And then lastly, Pastor John has some things outside. Pastor John, PJ, you have something outside, correct? If you guys can, right outside this door, to your right, is going to be a booth for Pastor John. Can you guys go by and check out that booth? He has some pretty great stuff for you guys to check out. You could also check out more of his stuff at pjdecuir.com. Amen? Did I say that right? JohnDecuir.com? JohnDecuir.com. Amen. That's it. That's it. All right, let's stand. Hallelujah. Let's stand. Let's welcome back our pastors, Pastor Charles and Andrea Humphrey.
Also, for those who had signed up to volunteer to help out with the golf tournament, we have a brief meeting about 20 minutes after service, so just stick around. We'll meet upstairs or meet me by the booth, the information booth, where Shimoda will be out there. Shimoda, wave your hand. If you plan to help out on the 17th for 1 hour, 2 hours, 3 hours, whatever, meet us at the booth. We'll have a quick meeting so you can know what's going on, okay? Thank you.
Everybody touching somebody. Real quickly, if you wanted to join Hope's House, the church is open for membership. We forgot to do that. You can see Shimoda with his hand up. He will be up here for just a few minutes at the end of service. We are a church that's open for membership. We're not a perfect church, just a church trying to get everybody to heaven, as many people as possible. Amen? Amen, amen, amen. For those of you who are visiting with us, join us in the pantry. We'd love to say hello, meet you, hug on you, find out how you found out about Hope's House, and just let you know we care about you. Amen? Amen. Give Pastor John a hand one more time for the word today. Want to welcome new baby back today, our family, the Burnetts. What's the baby's name? Isaiah. First time in church today. He's cute. He's cute. Mama looking good. Daddy looking proud. Chest all out. Give them some space, new babies. Don't be breathing and coughing all over the baby. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. But she said, Jesus, help. But welcome back, family. We missed you guys, and we're so glad to see you. Glad baby's healthy and safe. All right, let's close in prayer. Amen. Father, we thank you and praise you that you are the standard bearer. And we thank you, Lord God, that you are just doing amazing things in us and through us. Thank you for all the families visiting with us today. We pray that you've touched them in some way, Lord God, and caused them to know that you are real and that, Lord God, that you are the standard bearer for them as well. Father, we thank you, Lord God, that as we leave from this place, we not leave from your presence. We honor you and bless your name for just being present in this service. Father, we thank you for the upcoming week. Help us, Lord God, to be standard bearers in every atmosphere that we step into. And we thank you, Lord God, that we'll be great ambassadors for you. Thank you for your grace and your mercy. mercy. Bless Pastor John. Touch his body with complete healing from the top of his head to the soles of his feet. We give you all the glory and praise and honor for what you're doing in us and through us. In Jesus' matchless name, all God's people, one heart and one mind, said amen and amen. Hug your neighbor before you go and tell him to lift up the standard.
Hi, I'm Pastor Charles Humphrey, Senior Pastor of Hope's House Christian Ministries.
And I'm Andrea Humphrey, Co-Pastor of Hope's House Christian Ministries.
So we would like to thank you, first of all, for taking time to view our service. Now, if you are ever in the LA area visiting, or if you actually live locally, we'd love to invite you to come out to see what happens here at Hope's House, live and in person.
We have a saying around here, whose house? Hope's house. And we'd like to say, whose house? Your house. So, as my husband said, if you're ever in the area, come and join us.
Now, if you have any prayer requests, or if you just want more information about this particular ministry, you can write us by using an email address. Also, if you'd like to be a supporter of Hope's House, you can do so by using any of the giving options that you see on your screen at this time.
So again, we want to thank you for watching. We believe this is an amazing ministry with God doing really powerful things in the community, transforming lives. So join us every Sunday morning, live streaming here at Hope's House Christian Ministries. Thank you for watching.
God bless.